That is practical evangelism. Our life needs to be a living epistle where people can read. Do people call you man of God when you put on your suit? Or even when they find you in your slipper, they will say man of God. Religion having no real practical application, this is the crux of the message. If you are not living it, if you are living according to this false dichotomy, there won't be results. Let's take from the lesser light, spirit of prophecy. Powerful stuff. Modernism considers faith as primitive affair that ought to be kept out of the public arena. Some within the church find it handy to live within this false dichotomy. In this case, one's public life has nothing to do with one's religious life. This makes it impossible not to declare all income on the tax form, or underpay employees, cheat customers, to have unethical business practices, or pollute the environment. This behavior are explained away by statement, business is business. It's during the week, it's not Sabbath, so I get to do as I please. All men have been born with this infinite prize. By pouring the whole treasure of heaven into this world, by giving us Christ all heaven. Christ all heaven. God has touched the will, the affection, the mind, the soul of every human being. Whether believers or unbelievers, all men are the Lord's property. All are called to service for Him and for the manner in which they have met this claim. All would be required to render an account at the great day of judgment. One thing you can't say in the judgment, God actually will know. Because the Bible says, in Matthew chapter 24, verse 14, the gospel is going to be preached in all nations as a witness. So on that day, when you say, God, I didn't know, they will say, you didn't go to church, but I sent my servants in the train. And even if you don't go to church, you heard my will. One thing you will not say in the judgment is, I did not know what was expected of me. You will go to be accountable for every second that you spent under the sun. It sounds like great news, but it is good news that we should seek sanctification. First verse, I believe. Why should we witness with our lives? Why should we witness with our life? Why is it important that we should witness? Matthew chapter 28:18-20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. This is the scripture that got me to start preaching in the train. I remember my first day when I preached in the train, it was a Global Youth Day. It was last year. It wasn't so long day. I feel like I've been doing it for a while. Global Youth Day, and the youth at Mowbray gathered and we went to the train. My very first time, the desire has always been there to preach, but I was fearful. So we got there in the train, we remained here. I'm like, okay, now we are made, I've got makeup. So I started clobbering. It felt good, I tell you, to work with the Lord's video. And that was it. I said, oh, something I can do, really. Something that I can do. Come Monday, it was the Wednesday, I think. Get to train here in Pentec. Carrying my plan for mine right now. For some, I don't have the youth guys. It's not Global Youth Day anymore. I'm alone. I'm holding my Bible like this, and I said, I'm going to preach. I'm saying the people are wondering, I'm thinking I'm going to preach, and the train starts approaching. I start shaking. My first day, alone. The train comes. I get in the train. Instead of starting to preach, I sit. Okay, and I pretend like I'm just reading a Bible, just reading, not yet preaching. God went dramatic on me. Guess what? He sent an angel in the form of a beggar. This guy, smelling, torn and tattered clothes, he came to me. He says, give me a Bible. I said, what? He said, give me a Bible. So I gave him my Bible. He went to Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd. He started preaching to me. He's not large. People are looking at us. We are encouraging the train, and the train is moving. He says, I'm going to keep your life. So now I'm thinking, oof, I love this Bible. I wasn't going to let it go. So I stand up and I take the Bible from him. From there I began to preach. Guess what? He was with me until I got to Cape Town. Saying amen. Amen. Took out his small Bible, a beggar, torn with tattered clothes. Amen. send an angel. When we decide for God, God will impart the power. I tell you, when you decide to live for God, when you decide to do everything right, not for pride. I didn't choose the vegetables and well because I wanted to be noticed. No. When we decide for God, brethren, I tell you, when we live this gospel, great fruits are yielded that no man can expect. It is Christ's effort. Leave the gospel and you will not fail in mission. God will go dramatic with you. If need be, he will send a whole host of angels. Because he says, what? All power. And that's what my brother Bishop said the Sabbath before. I was telling him, I'm dreading, I'm fearful. He says, I need backup. And then he opened the scripture. He says, all power is given to Christ. So every time now when I open the train, I say, all power is given to Christ. And listen to the most powerful way. He says, what? Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I what? Even unto the end of the world. This is powerful. So when you are doing evangelism, this is your only time. I'm taking so much time. When you are doing evangelism, it is the only time where you will be sure that the Son of God is by your side. It's a promise. I am with you always. So whenever you open the Bible to preach to someone, Christ is there. And you should notice it by faith. My brothers, I can talk forever. But my message to you today is that be touched in your heart. Don't just download sermons and go and regurgitate these statements and, you know, boast about the things that you know. It will not profit you anything. You can know all the mysteries. You can know all the prophecies. But if you have not love, and you know that love, it's a love of God that loves unconditionally. Do you have a burden for souls? That's the question. Do you love your brethren to a point where you want to preach this good message to them? That's the message. And that's my message to you today. And as I close, I would like us to kneel, if we can, to just pay homage to Christ and to thank him for this message, and that we should carry this message with great zeal. Because we are the young people that can finish the work. In fact, I always say that there is a group of 124,000 that are going to proclaim this message at the end. And they will be translated without seeing death. Being the first Elijah. You know there are two Elijahs, right? John the Baptist and the Elijah in the Old Testament. John the Baptist, God is dead, chopped off. So some of us are going to skip this message. You know, but some will continue. The 144,000, 12 apostles to establish the first church, to spread the word, the gospel to the whole world. 12 squared is 144. That is just a mathematical deduction. Let us pray. Of Christ on Monday and every day of the week. In the mighty mighty name of Jesus Christ, I thank you, dear God, for your wonderfulness, for your greatness. May you seal this message in our hearts, and may you bless every individual in this day. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I thank you, God, for your love and kindness. Be with us, Lord, as we continue with the service. In Jesus Christ's name, Amen.